Welcome to Digital Radio UK's Drive to Digital 2020 Stakeholder Video Briefing. Over the next 90 minutes, we'll take a look back on digital radio's progress over the last 12 months and a look ahead to the key issues and developments for 2021. You will hear from broadcasters, the automotive industry, supply chain and retail experts, government and Ofcom. Let's start with a welcome and introduction from Digital Radio UK's Ford Ennals and Yvette Dore, with contributions from BBC's Jonathan Wall and Lorna Clark, Bauer's Ben Cooper and Minister John Whittingdale, who were speaking at the Radio Academy Radio Festival in November.
Hello, I'm Ford Ennals. I head up Digital Radio UK.
Hello, and I'm Yvette Dore, and I'm Communications Director at Digital Radio UK.
It's good to see you, Yvette, and welcome everybody. This is Drive to Digital 2020. It's a different Drive to Digital than you've probably ever experienced. There's no radio theatre here. There's no British Museum or British Library. What instead we have is a virtual programme of videos that will give you updates on 2020 and look forward to the key developments for digital radio in 2021. Now, you don't need to hear from me that what a challenging and difficult year this has been for radio. And indeed for the country. But what we do believe is that radio has in many ways risen above the challenges and has delivered to its listeners, to communities, and indeed to the nation, entertainment, news, information, and as I said, has really made its mark. And I think it's a year that the British radio industry can be proud of. So in this video, you have the opportunity to sit back and enjoy everything in one run. Equally, you have the opportunity to listen and watch to individual modules. Hopefully, when you add it all together, it'll paint a picture of digital radio in 2020 and how well it's poised for future growth. Now, Yvette, tell me, how's 2020 been for you?
Well, it's been an interesting year, and as you say, a year like no other. Despite the challenges, the radio industry has not stood still. We've had some hugely exciting developments in terms of station launches and content initiatives, and we'll be sharing more about those in a digital station news and content update later.
Thank you, Yvette. That's brilliant. And we're obviously very much looking forward to hearing more about the station news and the other developments from 2020 later in this video. But before we get going, what I wanted to do was share with you some of the comments made by some of the broadcast leaders and indeed the Minister, John Whittingdale. And they were talking at a Radio Academy event, the Radio Festival, just a few short weeks ago. And I think what they did was very much underline the role of radio this year and the importance of radio this year. And we're going to start by hearing from Jonathan Wall, who is controller of BBC Sounds at the BBC. And he'll talk a little bit about how important radio is right now. Let's hear from Jonathan.
Hi there, radio industry. So 2020, the strangest year, the hardest year, but potentially I think the finest year for this great industry of ours. Why do I say that? I want you to stop and think for a moment about the crucial role of companionship provided by our presenters, whether they be on national radio, local radio, community radio, giving what I think is a sense of normality in a world that's anything but normal. And think about the escapism provided by those great football commentators at Five Live and at TalkSport. They're sat in empty stadiums, for heaven's sake, somehow trying to convey that drama and excitement of the Premier League, which means none of us, by the way, have to pay £15 pay-per-view because radio's got it all covered. Then there's the information you get from a Today programme, from an LBC show, or indeed your ability to then go and just talk about everything you've heard over on Five Live. And let's not forget our music stations, both BBC and commercial, allowing us to enjoy live music performance when we can't get it from a festival, of course, or a club.
Great, thanks, Jono. Now let's hear from Bauer's new Group Director of Content and Music, Ben Cooper. Here's what Ben had to say about the importance of radio during this time.
I think 2020 and COVID has been almost a digital petri dish. We have fundamentally changed overnight the way that you and I work and the way that we operate in our day-to-day lives. But during that digital disruption, There's been 100-year-old technology that has been keeping us company during our enforced isolation. Radio. Radio is booming. What an exciting time. We have got figures that show how many people have been uptaking the use of their smart speaker to listen to radio or to use apps on their phone.
And it's great to see and hear Ben as passionate as ever. And here's someone who's new to their role, but not new to radio. It's someone who's got the most wonderful title of head of pop at the BBC. It's Lorna Clark. Let's hear what she has to say about how healthy audio is right now.
The competition is around the digital space. So what's been great is you look at the health of audio, whether it's in the commercial world with commercial radio or whether it's with BBC radio, it's hugely healthy. It's, you know, people have been calling on the death of radio for a long time. Spotify, Apple, all these things coming and they'll be like, radio's going to die. It's not. Mm. We have seen, if I compare radio services now to when I started long time ago, 1985, it totally exploded. I probably had a choice of three stations if I wanted to stay in London. That is absolutely not the case now. So my job is across platforms, but it's all about how do we get the best content around pop for audiences, and it's all ages.
Thanks, Lorna. And lastly, let's hear from John Whittingdale, the Minister of State for Media and Data, on the importance the government places on the radio sector and the vital role it plays.
I am very conscious that, first of all, radio really stepped up to the plate to respond to the challenge. The ability of radio to reach audiences and the trust which radio enjoys more than any other form of media does make it very powerful, and therefore we regard it as very important to support radio. And for instance, the package of support which was made available through all the different media for public information wasn't just a sort of bailout. I mean, it was because radio is very effective at reaching audiences, and I hope that that will continue because obviously public messaging remains very important.
Jono, Lorna, Ben and John Whittingdale have all painted a picture about the important role that radio is playing and how it's set for future growth. And we want to build on that now in this video programme. We want to talk about the specific contribution of digital radio and how digital radio is set for growth in 2021. And to do that, we'll be bringing you updates on station news and station developments. We'll be talking about retail and automotive updates. We're also hearing a little bit about the big news internationally.
Plus, we'll have a special presentation on Premier Christian Radio, which celebrates its 25th anniversary this year, from BBC R&D on the energy efficiency of radio platforms. And Ofcom will be sharing an update on the licensing and launch of small-scale multiplexes across the UK.
So stay with us and hear all about radio's digital revolution.
Good morning.
Welcome to Capital Breakfast.
It's the Dave Berry Breakfast Show on Absolute Radio.
Welcome along to your tea time extravaganza.
Welcome to radio's digital revolution. Radio has been around forever.
Wake up to Capital Radio.
But thanks to digital technology, radio is changing and reinventing itself to meet the needs of every generation.
Stop! What? You've got your bottom in my face.
Don't forget to stay right up!
From what you can hear to how you can hear it, radio is better than ever, with more stars, more shows, more music, and loads more news and sports. And with so many great digital stations, there is something for everyone. And it's not just radio. There are thousands of podcasts all available for free, featuring stars you know and love.
I reckon your phone book's amazing.
Ant, in brackets, deck.
Hello and welcome to Full Disclosure with me, James O'Brien.
And brilliant new up-and-comers with something to say.
What does it take for the word to be heard?
With more digital stations and more podcasts launching all the time, the only question is, what's your favourite? And it's easier to listen than ever before. Listen on digital radios, smart speakers, and of course it all sounds amazing on headphones.
We need to be serious, yes?
Radio is here for you to hear. So listen up and join radio's digital revolution. If you love radio, go digital.
Now let's hear from Charmaine Nobel-McLean of Premier Christian Radio, which this year celebrates its 25th anniversary on air, a year that has seen it become more important than ever in supporting its listeners through the COVID crisis.
So I'm delighted to be joined now by Charmaine Nobel-McLean, who is Director of Content of Premier, the leading broadcaster in Christian programming, which this year celebrates its 25th anniversary on air. Charmaine, hello. Thank you so much for talking to me today. It's so great to see you.
Lovely to see you as well, Yvette.
Thank you. Now, Premier Christian Radio was a pioneering digital station launching nationally on DAB in 2009, and you continue to pioneer with two further stations launching on the second national commercial multiplex in 2016, Premier Gospel and Premier Praise. So Charmaine, congratulations on the 25th anniversary.
Thanks.
But I expect 2020 has not been quite the anniversary you and your colleagues at Premier were anticipating. But that said, the vital role you play in supporting the community and your audiences has never been more apparent and necessary than during this COVID crisis. So thinking back to March and the first lockdown, what specific measures were needed to enable you to keep your stations on air?
Gosh, it feels like eons ago when you asked me that question to reflect back, but we, our CEO pulled us into some very quick, hard meetings and had a really clear plan. One of the things we realised was that we really needed to make sure we were tonally relevant to the disaster, the crisis, the immediate upset that many people, all of us, were experiencing at that time, that disbelief. And so we made some pretty radical changes to our formats across all three stations. We changed presenters, we pulled back on imaging, pulled out everything that just didn't sound tonally right. And all were in agreement that what Premier could offer to our listeners at this time in March was to be a voice of hope. And that was the message we carried across all of our platforms, network, the radio stations, as well as our digital platforms as well. We knew that in these times where people were lost and wondering what on earth was going to happen, we were seeing deaths, the death numbers piling up so quickly and the horror of that, we knew that we had to give what the church's message is that, and that's a message of hope. And so there was a lot of rug pulling, there was a lot of pulling of the tablecloth, and it felt like things were crashing all over the place. But somehow, and I guess it's by God's grace, we were able to get ourselves into a position where our audience, and I had an email from someone just earlier this week actually, who said that Premier has helped sustain her through these two lockdown periods. She's lost her husband, and somehow the message was just right for her in her time of need. And when we get that kind of message, you know we're doing the right thing, and that's a deep listener engagement that we have, a message of hope in the midst of a time of real, you know, unprecedented times, as people are still saying.
And were there specific content or outreach initiatives that you put in place to additionally support the needs of your listeners through COVID?
Yeah, there's a number of things we did, and a lot of them we did online. So fairly quickly, we began to launch digital webinars, which were purposed to serve and support church leaders, people who are involved in normal day-to-day activities of parachurch life, whether it was mums and toddler groups that couldn't meet anymore, to youth clubs or youth groups, or helping with the elderly. So we put on a host, and I think we've done so far about 30 of them, with an average about 150 people attending each time, sometimes 500, so it was depending on what the subject was, where they would be able to come and hear from experts in the field and get practical help. It was kind of twofold. One was a time of prayer and fellowship, you know, to gather together and share in our experiences, but you would be given real practical tools on how to deliver what you were doing in physical form in a digital space, you know, going forward. So that's been really popular. And actually just last month, we are in December now, our PremDAC, Premier Digital Conference, it's an annual conference, which is normally hosted in London. You know, loads of people come from all over the country. Well, we had 1,000 people attending this massive online sequence of seminars and sessions. And that's been really popular. So we've been trying to make sure that we continually equip the church and individuals, Christians, to do what they've been called to do in the digital space. So that's been a massive focus of our work over the past 9 months or so.
Yeah. So digital innovation and distribution has really helped in enabling you to reach your audiences.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's surprising because a lot of churches, just like we had to, learn to adapt really quickly. It's taken a little bit longer for some, but we've tried to make sure we help cover all of those churches, whether they're a parish church of 10 people or they're a massive church who've got some really skilled people in their areas. Yeah. There's something that everybody can learn from and share. And it's been fantastic, actually, the amount of support that other churches are giving to others through Premier, which has been brilliant.
And are you seeing a really high engagement from your listeners as well in terms of how they're responding to?
Absolutely. Yeah, we are. You know, there's the engagement in terms of hearing stories of what key workers have been doing, what their life experience has been, from church leaders who are offering prayer and support in their areas, from ordinary people who are challenged by their experiences, you know, many people having multiple members of their families who are affected by the pandemic. Maybe they've got, you know, somebody working in a hospital, but they're also caring for somebody who's quite elderly. So we've had quite a range. But one of the things I wanted to mention to you about is in terms of Premier Lifeline, which is 25 years old as well, it was launched at the same time as Premier Christian Radio. The numbers of calls we've seen has massively increased. You know, it's about a quarter, 25% of increase on calls from this time last year. And what's quite telling is, apart from the normal kinds of calls that we get, where it might be people struggling with loneliness, relationship issues, just the stuff of life, we're starting to get calls, or we have been since lockdown, getting calls from people talking about feeling crushed, feeling real. I mean, these are some strong words that they're using in their calls for prayer. Furlough, redundancy, worry and stress about having the virus, loneliness because of isolation. These are the kinds of things that our listeners are calling in to talk to us about. And what we try to do is reflect that back to say, well, if you're feeling like this, this is how you can get help. This is what we can do to support you in those times. So it's kind of a full circle.
Yes. And the role of radio has just never been more apparent, has it, in how you're supporting.
Absolutely.
And with Christmas coming up, and specifically, people won't be able to gather and go to church in the way that they usually do. So how are your three stations going to fill that gap and help the community cope without such an important element of Christmas for so many?
We've got such a packed lineup across our networks for Christmas. On Premier Christian Radio, we're trying to make sure that we provide the traditional, real meaning of Christmas with all of the normal services that you'd expect to go to. Lots of people like to go out to their normal carol services at Christmas, even if that's the only time they ever darken the halls of a church. And so we will do, you know, your nativity. We've got a lovely cutesy one called Tea Towels and Tinsel, which will be broadcast on Christmas morning. We've got nine lessons and carols, and, you know, the carols by candlelight. And for the first time this year, because many people do like to go to a midnight mass or a midnight communion, so we're going to broadcast a service that people, and we're encouraging people to listen and take part in the event, you know, actually follow the event through, you know, take communion, prepare and have a little bit of wine and bread if you want to. So feel like you're part of a national service with other people in your own living room or your bedroom, wherever you are. So we're trying to make sure that all the trappings of Christmas are reflected through our radio stations. But we do also know that there are some churches that will try to make sure that they are providing digital services for their communities as well. So we've provided some, we've created some free resources that you can get online, which include carol videos with lyrics, which make it a lot easier for people to follow, some lovely reflections that they can use as part of their service with people like Pam Rose, who's a well-known face of Songs of Praise and a presenter on Premier Christian Radio as well. So we're just trying to say, well, if you're a church and you need to pull something together, we'll help you. If you're an individual and you can't get out to church, we'll bring church to you in your living room, wherever you are. Have your sherry and a mince pie and enjoy the festivities as far as you can with us.
Charmaine, that's fantastic. Thank you so much for being part of our update for stakeholders. It's been so great to talk to you and hear more about how you've been supporting your listeners during these challenging times, and so great to hear about the plans for Christmas. So I'm going to wish you a happy Christmas.
And you.
Thank you, and look forward to seeing you in 2021. Charmaine, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And with news of digital station launches and development in 2020, here's Yvette Dorr with contributions on small-scale DAB from Ash Elford and David Duffy.
Hi everyone, I'm here to update you on the key digital station and content news we've seen in 2020. Now, usually in an update like this, I'd kick off with a few slides on the latest digital listening data from Radar, but I can't do that today, as one of the consequences of COVID on the radio industry has unfortunately been the suspension of the Radar survey, because elements of the survey use face-to-face methodology. So the most recent official Radar figures we have are for Q1 2020. And in the meantime, the Radar team have been working hard developing a new approach for measurement, which will launch in Q1 2021. In the absence of the Radar, we do have some data points to give us a steer on how radio listening has fared this year from, for example, Ofcom's Media Nations report, Radar's tracking study during lockdown, Radio Centre research, and also broadcasters' live streams of their stations. And all of these sources would indicate that despite disruption in terms of location of listening, radio listening has remained robust and more important to listeners than ever during these challenging times. So the last formal measurement for digital listening was for Q1 2020, at which point digital listening had increased to 58.6% of all listening, with the majority of digital listening being to DAB, accounting for 40% of all listening, but the fastest growing being listening online, which now accounts for 14% of all listening, driven by the popularity of listening via smart speakers. So now for station news. So despite the challenges of the pandemic and the immediate impact on the broadcaster's operations and revenues, 2020 has seen a number of station launches and significant content and schedule initiatives. In January this year, News UK announced the launch of Times Radio, a new speech radio station in partnership between The Times, The Sunday Times and Wireless. The station launched at the end of June with a stellar lineup of broadcasters and journalists, including Asim Amir, Stig Abel, John Pienaar, and Mariella Frostrup. And it's available nationally on DAB and also online and smart speakers. Here's a flavour of the station.
Since 1785, The Times has been essential reading.
Times Radio chooses conversation over confrontation.
Covers Westminster and beyond. Ask the right questions
to keep you well informed.
We give word space and let the stories do the talking.
Times Radio, know your times.
It's 4:30, this is Times Radio Drive.
The second major brand new digital station to launch this year is Capital Dance from Global. Playing dance anthems and club mixes, the station launched on the 1st of October in DAB Plus on Digital One and online and on smart speakers. And is fronted by the popular DJ and producer, Mr. Jam. Here's a clip.
Eat, sleep, rave, repeat.
Your energy flows.
Welcome to Capital Dance.
Oh my God, this feeling's just begun.
Crank it.
And it just goes on. Time to make the car go up.
I call it housework.
You got to pump it up.
Welcome to Capital Dance, the UK's official dance station.
In a good month for dance music fans, also in October, Radio 1 Dance launched on BBC Sounds, providing a second chance to hear Radio 1's famous mixes and DJs, including Pete Tong, in the BBC's first new 24-hour stream on BBC Sounds.
Radio 1 Dance.
Brand new stream of the biggest dance shows on the planet.
Where you can listen to the world's best dance music.
Anytime, anywhere. 24/7. Available now on BBC Sounds.
Also this year, we've seen Bauer rolling out greatest hits radio to many more areas of the UK, including across multiple local DAB multiplexes. The station plays hits of the 70s, 80s and 90s and is fronted by presenters such as Mark Goodyear, Janice Long and Paul Gambaccini. I remember when I was young.
The biggest songs of the 70s, 80s and 90s.
Greatest Hits Radio. The good times sound like this.
This year, we've also seen some exciting schedule changes and movements on digital stations. This includes Jordan and Perry fronting a brand new weekday breakfast show on KISS. And in January 2021, Graham Norton will join Virgin Radio to host a flagship weekend show on Saturdays and Sundays. Now, a really important initiative this year has been the continued rollout of DAB+. With the launch of Capital Dance and Times Radio this year, there are now 54 national stations broadcasting in DAB or DAB+. And of those, 24, and you can see them on screen now, are broadcasting in DAB+. So this year, we've seen stations launching nationally in DAB+, such as Smooth Chill and Capital Dance. And we've seen stations moving from DAB to DAB+, such as Talk Radio and Talk Sport 2. This means, as this slide shows, that of the 54 national stations, 24 are now broadcasting in DAB+, which is more than half of the total of national commercial digital stations.
And hot off the press, the Jack Radio Group have announced two further new national stations, Union Jack Rock and Union Jack Dance, which will launch on Friday the 11th of December.
DAB Plus is simply a more efficient form of DAB, which allows for more stations to be broadcast. Although the majority of new digital radios are DAB Plus compatible, there are many radios in use in home, indeed the majority of them that aren't. So this expansion of DAB Plus stations represents an opportunity for digital radio manufacturers and retailers. One area that has already seen a huge expansion in the number of DAB Plus stations and is set to see more is Ofcom's plans for licensing small-scale DAB multiplexes in areas across the UK. They are looking at potentially licensing multiplexes in up to 200 areas, which could see the launch of hundreds, possibly thousands of new local, commercial and community stations. We will be hearing from Ofcom on small scale shortly, but before we do, let's hear now from David Duffy of Niacom Associates and Ash Elford of Angel Radio, who have both been operating stations and multiplexes as part of the small-scale trials.
The very first small-scale multiplex to have a DAB Plus service was my one in Portsmouth. And the first one to have all DAB Plus services was your one in Manchester. So well done for pipping me to the post on that one.
Nice.
You know, obviously going from DAB to DAB Plus has meant that, you know, between us, we've been able to ask more stations on our multiplexes. So what kind of stations are we broadcasting on small scale DAB?
Well, using DAB Plus has meant we can fit more stations on. And that's also one of the big successes of small scale DAB is the sheer variety. So we've got community and commercial broadcasters, analog broadcasters who are now simulcasting on a digital platform, which is fabulous. But also lots of new formats have come out of the woodwork, specialist formats, music specialists like rock and soul. We've also got genre specific 80s and 90s stations, lots of religious stations, Christian, Muslim, and a plethora of speech stations, rolling news, rolling weather. And we've even got podcast radio as a platform. Who would have thought podcasting going onto a broadcast platform? It's superb. And of course, as we near Christmas, pop-ups are going to be the thing. And I think you've already launched a pop-up, haven't you, in Portsmouth?
That's right. Yeah, 1st of October, Christmas radio. We've talked about the last 5 years. What's it going to look like in 5 years' time?
Well, the really exciting thing is the future is here now today, because after 5 years, Ofcom, the regulator here, have started advertising the first 25 areas, 25 polygons, as they're called. And that's just the beginning. Over the next 5 years, they're going to advertise 228 small-scale DAB licenses. So the future begins today. So that's what I find really, really exciting. What about yourself?
Do you know what? I'm totally with you on that one. And I'll tell you what, I think, you know, you're absolutely right. You know, we're going to see over 200 of these plexes in the UK in the next 5 years. And I think, here's one for you, in 5 years' time in the UK, we will have 2,000 new cities on digital radio around the country. I think that is phenomenal.
The development of small-scale DAB technology has been led by Ofcom and provides a route to digital for small local commercial and community stations. Here with an update are Ofcom's Peter Madry and John Heesman.
Hello and welcome. It's Peter Madry from Ofcom here. My colleague John Heesman and I are going to speak for a few minutes to let you know what's been happening in the world of small-scale DAB. Firstly, I'll give a recap on what small-scale DAB is and how we've got to where we are now. Then John will speak about our programme of licensing, including an update on the first round of licences. Finally, there'll be a look forward to what happens next. Now, as you'll all know, the UK has a well-established digital radio platform providing coverage to over 90% of households, with some national services serving over 97%. Now, that coverage is either UK-wide or targeted at county-sized areas, often several counties, and that suits national broadcasters or larger commercial services and BBC local radio, because it's at the scale that those broadcasters are trying to target. However, that scale of coverage can be too large and the cost of achieving it too high for smaller broadcasters, particularly community radio. So the ethos behind small-scale DAB is to provide a third tier of digital broadcasting to complement national and local multiplexes, but targeting towns or parts of large cities. Small-scale also offers a migration path to digital for community radio and small commercial stations if they wish to broadcast on DAB. Over the past few years, we've carried out trials using low-cost hardware, which enables a DAB multiplex to be established for a similar cost to a small FM station. Government has taken legislation through Parliament to provide a framework for licensing those small-scale services, and the legislation has brought in two new types of license. There's a small-scale multiplex license, which is for the vehicle that actually transmits the programme services, and there is the Community Digital Sound Programme Service license, known as a CDSP, which is the digital equivalent of the analogue community radio license. And that covers community radio content carried on the multiplex. Holders of regular DSP licenses, that's Digital Sound Programme Service licenses, can also be carried on small-scale multiplexes. So where are we now? Well, Ofcom has just finished advertising the first round of licences, and I'll hand over to John, who will tell us a bit more about our licensing programme.
Thank you, Peter. So we consulted in 2019 about how we plan to license small-scale DAB services, with the final statement being published in April earlier this year. Because small-scale DAB is a brand new tier of broadcasting, we'd previously sought expressions of interest to find out where there is the demand and how large people wanted the coverage areas to be. We then developed a frequency plan based on the expressions of interest. That plan has just over 200 multiplex areas across the UK. As that's a vast amount of applications to advertise and assess all in one go, we plan to advertise the multiplex licences in batches. We expect to advertise one batch approximately every 6 months. The window for applying for CDSP licenses in the multiplex areas being advertised also opens at the same time. We'll review the rate at which we're advertising the licenses. That'll be based on the number of applications we get and their quality, and also on Ofcom's available resources. So talking about round one then, the multiplex advertisements, which has just passed. Round one contains 25 locations, as you can see there on the map. It opened on the 1st of September and it's recently closed on the 23rd of November. We had 45 multiplex applications in total, and so far 7 CDSP license applications. There's at least one multiplex applicant for each of the 25 areas, which is obviously very good news, with the most contested area being Leeds, which attracted 5 applicants. We've now started to assess the applications against the criteria that's set out in the legislation. That'll involve confirming that applicants are able to hold licences, assessing their ability to launch their services and the extent of transmission coverage that they're proposing to achieve. We're going to be looking at the evidence of demand or support from the providers of programme services and the involvement of CDSP licensees in the applicant bodies. And finally, steps the applicants have or plan to take to ensure fair and effective competition in the operation of their multiplex. So what are the next steps going to be? Well, we're most likely to announce the awards in batches starting next year, which will be accompanied by award statements. Some areas have only got a single applicant, so hopefully they will be a bit quicker to assess. The next round, round two, will be for the northwest of England and northeast Wales, which we plan to advertise in March 2021. Subsequent rounds will follow at approximately 6-month intervals. We haven't yet decided on which areas will constitute round three or the following rounds, although we have said that London and the South East won't be advertised before round four. And that's all because we still need to complete international negotiations on frequencies with neighbouring countries in Europe. We will publish, incidentally, details of locations in round three when we're advertising round two, if that makes sense. So thank you very much for listening. And on behalf of myself and Peter and everyone at Ofcom, we wish you all a safe December and a really happy Christmas and New Year.
Retail continues to be an important destination for choosing and buying our audio devices, but increasingly we are going online. Here with an update on retail, smart speakers and Digital Radio UK's new e-learning platform, our retail analyst Jack Wetherill of Futuresource and retail expert Kerry Marks of Ignite.
Hello, this is our retail session, and as we've indicated, retail is a really important area for the radio category. It's where people buy their radio and audio devices. It's where people go to get the information and to browse. So it remains important to us, but we're also very aware that through this year, it's been a very challenged area. And we're going to have a conversation about that and about what the future holds. And we're starting with Jack Wetherill, who's joining us today. Jack, welcome.
Thank you very much.
It's very good. Very good to see you. Jack, so much has happened this year. It's been such a challenging year. What do you see as the fundamental impact on retail?
Of the pandemic, yeah. Of course, you're talking of, well, of course, it's been hellish for anybody on the high street. It's so difficult to plan, to know exactly what's going to happen when your customers are going to be able to come back into stores. So it's been so difficult. Of course, that's a general retail statement. But when you think about electronics, some stores have managed to stay open. So supermarkets, for example, deemed essential retailers because they've got food, have perhaps benefited, or should we say, suffered less than others when it comes to electrical sales. And of course, anybody who has already invested in their online retail platform and planned ahead will have benefited from that, let's say, over the last couple of years. John Lewis would be a good example, I think, where they already had their ducks in a row, if you like. So they were able to, if you like, take advantage of that in order to maximise their sales online when they couldn't sell offline.
Thanks, Jack. I mean, that you're absolutely right. You make interesting points about retail. But looking more specifically at audio in particular, what's happened during the pandemic through this year? Have sales grown? Have they declined? And, you know, and who are the winners and losers?
Yeah, well, it's been a tricky year for forecasters, that's for sure. You know, what's happened as the year has unfolded has been very interesting. And actually, you might find this chart of interest, where we have the consumer response to audio during the pandemic. And we did a survey just with consumers just during the first lockdown. And that's during, I think, April time. And basically, of course, people won't really buy hardware unless they've got a good reason to use it. And we asked people about what they were listening to. And we found that music streaming, that if you look in green, 40% said they were listening to more music streams than they were before, with just 52% the same. Perhaps the easiest way to look at this is how many people are saying they're doing less, and it's actually very small. So in other words, music streaming is growing. People are watching more music videos on YouTube. Podcast listening is growing. And indeed, radio listening is growing. So, of course, what does this mean? They're using hardware for all of these activities, of course, and that doesn't necessarily translate into new hardware sales, because of course people may already have the devices already. So when we look on the right hand side, there, the UK audio hardware markets. This is the first three quarters of this calendar year. The actual volume has declined a little bit, but value has grown drastically. Now, this is explained by the fact the categories that we're tracking on a quarterly basis, so we've got really granular data for, includes headphones, wireless speakers, soundbars, and all-in-one hi-fi systems, so sort of like microsystems of old. And if you put all of those together and count up the units, then it's down a bit. But if you look in terms of value, it's grown hugely. And that real value growth, yes, soundbars, average prices are growing a bit. Same with smart speakers hi-fi systems. But that's kind of a small growth. It's actually headphones that's really making the difference here. That shift from regular headphones to true wireless in-ear headphones is making a huge difference to average prices, and that's why the value is going through the roof. So any retailers who are selling headphones, especially true wireless, should be doing good business. And indeed, it's quite nice because it's a much higher average selling price per unit.
Yeah.
So less work has to go into it.
You'd argue even being flat as a category, you know, during a pandemic where we've had two lockdowns and stores closed, is a pretty strong position.
I totally agree with you, Ford. And it's worth remembering that one of those categories is more of a legacy one. The CD playback device is something that has been on the wane for years, of course, and that's included in here.
And Jack, if we just change gears and actually think a little bit about one part of the audio market, which is smart speakers, and talk a bit about the sort of historical growth of smart speakers, and indeed where you think that rate of growth is going, and how many smart speakers will we sell over the next few years?
Yeah, sure. I've put some kind of numbers to years here. Of course, they're relatively new devices, aren't they? I think they first came to market, I think it was around 2015 with Amazon. Already by the end of 2018, there were nearly 8 million in use. That will have doubled, we figure, this year to over 16 million, with around 5 million units selling this year. And as I think I mentioned earlier, by next year, we will actually see more smart speakers in use than DAB radios in home, that is. And that trajectory continues around 27 million in use by 2024. And, you know, that's based on a sort of fairly a rapidly maturing, if you like, flattening line of sales, but still an upwards trajectory in terms of units as well.
Well, Jack, look, thank you so much for joining us. We look forward to maybe checking with you next year and seeing just how true all that is.
But, well, let's hope so. Again, yeah.
Thanks again for your time, and have a very good end of year and Christmas. Thank you.
Thanks, Ford. My pleasure. Thank you. Bye-bye.
As we heard from Jack, retail remains very important for the radio industry. And it's really great news to see all the retail stores open for Christmas. And retail continues to be a priority for Digital Radio UK, retail partnerships and retail education. And I'm delighted to welcome an expert, a retail expert, Kerry Marks, who's the director of Ignite UK. Kerry, welcome.
Thank you.
And we're going to talk a little bit about retail, but retail staff also, and retail education, which has been a key priority. So Kerry, you work with many different retail clients, and obviously this has been an incredibly challenging year. What's been the main impact for your retail clients?
Yeah, absolutely. So as a sort of field marketing agency and a digital agency, we work a lot with retail partners where we have a lot of staff that work within store as promoters and trainers. So obviously it has had a huge impact on us as an agency, the sort of movement from people shopping in store to shopping online with COVID-19. But what has happened is it has supported us with a transition to move very much to focus on digital tools. So a lot of our brands have moved very quickly. They're quite agile. And what they've done is move the investment that they had in sort of field teams into digital tools that will help them still to sell using online as their sales tool.
And you mentioned, Kerry, the shift to online sales, and I guess people are getting more and more used to that.
Yeah.
And if that continues, and do you think it will continue? And if it does, what's going to be the impact on retail stores? Are they going to disappear, do you think, over time?
I think there's absolutely going to be a change in the high street. I don't think there's any doubt that what's happened over the last 6 months will have a big impact on how retail goes forward. But I think there's always going to be a demand for a level of retail, especially the larger stores that we see. But I think what will happen is that we will see brands focus very heavily on digital tools for training and digital tools for one-to-one direct video sales, or looking at how they can absolutely capitalize on the online market as much as they were previously capitalizing on the actual sort of bricks and mortar store itself. But many of our clients are investing in digital, but they are still hopeful that over the next 12 months, we'll see the retail staff return to store, and we will still see that engagement piece happening within a retail store environment.
And what about, thanks, Kerry, and what about retail staff? I know that you spend a lot of time with them. I mean, how is this going to impact their role?
Yeah, I mean, it's been obviously very tough on the retail staff. And I think that there will be less opportunities and roles in retail for staff as, you know, we see a reduction in the high street. But many of them are looking at sort of moving over to transition their skills into digital roles. So something that's a big growth area for retail at the moment online is one-to-one video sales. So whereas you might have had a retail member of staff selling within the radio category within store, they can actually do one-to-one sales using video sales online. So many of the retail staff that are looking at, you know, their future career within this industry will be looking to digital for opportunities going forward.
Thank you. And once again, continuing on the theme of staff, I know your company Ignite did a retail staff audit earlier in the year, and to understand, you'd get a better sense of what their understanding of digital radio is. Can you share with us some of the key findings?
Yeah, I think for us, when speaking with the staff, it was very clear that they didn't really understand how much content was available to them for digital radio, and actually the content that all of the audio category could reach. And I think there was a big education piece that was needed there to give them that insight. I felt that, you know, looking at the results that we had, that many of the people had the idea that radio was for the older generation and not for the younger generation. And I think that was absolutely one of the key findings that came out of that. Some of the other areas that we identified was around education and knowledge. So understanding terminologies around digital radio. And that was an area that we wanted to support with education, so that when somebody is selling in the radio category, they can really show the customer how much content, you know, they will be able to access if they were to purchase a product within the audio category.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there clearly was a sort of knowledge gap with retail staff. And I think they didn't really seem to have a clear understanding of just how many stations had been launched. And as you say, how much content there was now available. Now, in response to that, your team has put together a digital radio e-learning site. I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about that. How does it work?
Yeah, absolutely. So the concept behind the e-learning site was to give the retail staff a tool where they would be able to access information about digital radio and all of the amazing content that's available, that's kept up to date. So at all times, they can share that with their customers. So the e-learning site is about giving them an insight into the amazing content in digital radio, also helping them to understand the terminology based around the products. But at the same time, I think for many of the retail staff, it's also building some brand advocacy with digital radio, and also giving them a little bit of an incentive and inspiring them to want to learn and want to talk more about digital radio as a whole.
And is this something that staff actually are used to using with other brands? And how will they find out about it? And how do you get them to engage in this?
Yeah, so especially within the larger retail stores, staff are very, very used to using learning management tools. And many brands provide either a learning management system of their own for them to access. Some retail stores will have their own learning management systems where they upload the content. And some stores will just share ad hoc links to microsites or training tools or training videos. There's been a huge investment in video and e-learning tools since the move to COVID-19, because we can't get into store to be face-to-face training people. And so the staff are very used to utilizing these tools to increase their knowledge within their product category, and also for them to feel connected to the brands that they're selling and feel inspired and engaged to want to sell more.
Okay, Kerry, that sounds great. I just wondered, in terms of the reaction you're getting from your retail clients, I mean, how are they perceiving the e-learning site and the story about digital radio?
Yeah, absolutely. So they've been really impressed at the level of content that's in the site. They were excited about how engaging the website is. I think one of the things that stood out is they didn't actually understand themselves how many channels and how much content and podcasts and stations there were in digital radio. And so I think not only are they happy to sort of share that with their staff, but they're also excited about their staff being incentivized to engage with digital radio and understand and learn more, because at the end result means they're going to sell more products within their radio category for them.
Brilliant. Well, look, many thanks for taking the time to share that with them. I mean, good luck with the initiative.
And
I hope that you and all your retail partners have a very, very good Christmas. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Ford. Appreciate it.
In a presentation made for the World DAB General Assembly, next we hear from Chloe Fletcher of BBC Research and Development on the energy footprint of BBC radio services across platforms and possible scenarios for the future.
Hello everybody, my name is Chloe Fletcher. I'm a sustainability data scientist working within BBC Research and Development. My role is to use data modelling and analysis to evaluate the environmental impact of media technology and services. So in today's talk, I'll be taking you through a recent project looking at the energy footprint of BBC Radio. I've only got 10 minutes, so if you're interested in learning a little bit more, you can check out the paper we published last week towards the end of the session. So what were we trying to achieve? Our main objective was to understand how much energy was required to prepare, distribute, and consume BBC Radio. So not just what the BBC is directly responsible for, but also in the consumption of our content. And then we wanted to understand how this energy may change over time. If we were to switch off certain platforms in the future, what impact could that have on the total energy? And lastly, we wanted to understand where the key hotspots are in the system. Where do we need to focus our efforts if we want to reduce our energy footprints? How did we go about this? Our research was split into two key parts. We had our baseline, so looking at energy as it stands today, and we used the reference year of 2018. And then we modelled a variety of scenarios, and we did that over a 20-year time period to understand the future dynamics. And also for radio, we've not just considered live content, we've also considered podcasts and catch-up within our scope. So just to give you a bit of context of what the BBC radio system looks like, this map here shows you the point of production all the way until the listener's ears. So we've not actually included production in our scope, but everything that happens from that point. As you can see, we offer a variety of different platforms in order to listen to radio. We have AM, which includes medium wave and long wave, FM, DAB, DTV radio services, which are available on terrestrial, cable and satellite. And also we have our internet distribution, which includes BBC Sounds, as well as content available on other platforms such as Spotify and YouTube. And as you can see in this map, we've color-coded it in where it fits within the radio chain. So we've got preparation, which includes playout, encoding, and multiplexing. We've got distribution, which includes the transmitter networks, as well as the internet infrastructure. And lastly, we have consumption, which includes all the devices in which you can listen to radio. And I don't have time to go into our full methodology. However, essentially what we've done is translate this system map here into a mathematical model, which outputs energy on a monthly basis for each of the components you see within this map. So jumping straight into our baseline results, here you can see the energy use for each radio platform in 2018. At the bottom is the total of all the platforms together, which was 325 gigawatt hours. To put that into a bit more context, that's about 0.1% of UK energy use in 2018. And FM had the highest share overall at about 31% of the total energy, and AM had the lowest at 8%. And for DAB, it sat somewhere in the middle at about 20%. So consumer devices were shown to be the biggest part of the chain. They used up nearly 3/4 of the total energy within our system, which was actually a bit of a surprising result, as transmitter networks are often touted as being the high power consuming things. But actually what we see here is that the consumer devices are using a lot more energy, which actually does make sense, because even though on an individual basis they might be quite low powered, when we're scaling up to the tens of millions, actually that can really add up in terms of energy use. And when we zoom into this even further, what we see is that the three biggest components within our system are analog radio sets, DAB radio sets, and television sets, which collectively make up more than 50% of the total energy. And when we zoomed in even further, what we saw is that the biggest contributor was the standby power of radio sets, as well as smart speakers. However, not all the platforms are listened to equally. As we can see here, FM and DAB have a much higher listenership than AM and DTV radio services. Therefore, perhaps a better way to compare platforms would be to look at the energy consumption per hour of listening. And when we do that, we actually see a very different picture, in that DTV radio services has got the biggest footprint at 81 watt hours per device hour, whereas DAB has the lowest at 9 watt hours per device hour. So essentially, DAB uses a ninth of the energy per hour of listening than DTV radio services, which is quite intuitive, because if you're listening to the radio on a television, you've got a screen and perhaps a set-top box associated with that. What's also interesting is that FM uses approximately 40% more energy per hour than DAB, and that's mainly because of the higher power consumption of the FM transmitter network, and that the DAB radios tending to have a lower standby power on those devices. So this just gives a bit of a quick summary of the results for our baseline. As I said previously, we published our paper last week, so you can read a little bit more detail about the results we got, as well as some sensitivity analysis considering how confident we are in those results as well. So moving on to our scenario results, it's probably worth me introducing what the scenarios we actually considered within the study. So we looked at four different indicative cases to test the modelling capability that we had. It's worth noting that these do not represent the intentions of the BBC, and they've just been used here for illustrative purposes. So we have used the business as usual case, so essentially keeping on all the platforms that we offer now for the next 20 years. And then we've looked at a digital only case, so considering if we turned off all our analog services from 2030, what impact that would be. And we've got scenario two, where we keep on DAB and IP and switching off analog and DTV radio services at 2030. And lastly, we have this IP only case where we switch off all of our other platforms from 2030. And it's worth bearing in mind that we've assumed a sudden switch off at 2030 happening overnight instead of a gradual process, which would be more likely to happen in reality. So in our business as usual case, we can see that there's very little difference in the total energy over the 20-year time period. There's some dynamics within that, in that you can see that the AM and FM listenership decreases over time, as well as the IP devices consuming more energy over time. And that's just because of how we've modelled them to their natural popularity over time. And this was shown, of all the scenarios we looked at, to be the worst outcome. So essentially, we shouldn't just keep things as they are now. And then moving on to scenario one, where we switch off all our analog services, there is a slight energy reduction compared to business as usual. But in all the switch off scenarios that we considered, this was shown to have the smallest reduction overall. And this is despite there being a removal in the AM and FM infrastructure. What we see at the point of 2030 is that there's only a 0.03% drop in the energy. And that's mainly due to there being a greater uptake in DTV radio services that we've modelled, as well as a greater uptake in smart speaker use. And so we ran a bunch of different configurations of what devices people might switch to after analog services were switched off. And what we actually saw was that if more people move to DTV radio services, we could actually see an increase in the total energy. And if more people move to DAB, then we could actually see a greater decrease. And then looking at this second scenario, if we were just to retain DAB and IP, we actually saw the biggest reduction of all the scenarios that we modelled. We saw a 23% drop at 2030, which was sustained for the remaining period of time. So of all the scenarios, this is probably the best environmental benefit that we could see. And lastly, if we were just to migrate to IP-only radio services, we did see a reduction in the total energy, but we only saw half the capacity of energy saving that we saw in the previous scenario. And this is not quite as pronounced as previously because we've removed DAB from the system, which we showed in our baseline result to actually have the lowest footprint per hour. So that's kind of why we're seeing that there. And as we saw in the baseline results, also in our scenarios, we saw that standby power of radio sets and smart speakers were by far the biggest contributor to the energy result that we were seeing. So an interesting thing we thought we would test out would be if we were to remove standby power from the system, if standby power was set to zero from 2021, what impact that could have on the total energy. And when we did that, what we saw was that we could actually see a 38% reduction in the total energy. And what this would mean in reality is that people remove their devices from their power source when not in use. And although this might be unfeasible in practice, what it does reveal to us is that any reductions in the standby power could have a significant impact on the total energy. And, you know, that could be affected through audience behavior, but that could also be affected through regulation of consumer electronic devices, as well as through manufacturers reducing the power consumption of their devices. So to summarise, from a sustainability perspective, we shouldn't be carrying on as business as usual, as all our scenarios showed energy saving potential. And of all of them, we saw that keeping on DAB and IP led to the largest energy saving by far. However, our results were highly dependent on which devices people switch to. Therefore, messaging around that would be really critical if we were to turn off certain platforms. And also, lastly, it's really important to mention that the radio set and smart speaker standby power was very significant. Therefore, any avenues that we could explore to reduce that would be really critical. So that would be audiences, regulators, and manufacturers. This research reveals the importance of taking a system-wide approach when considering the environmental impacts of services, products, and technology. So thank you very much for watching. Please feel free to pop me over an email if you have any questions or wanted to discuss any of this further. We suggest you check out our paper, which is available on the BBC R&D website if you want to learn a little bit more. Thank you very much.
Radio and the car have always been great companions, and radio listening in cars continues to grow. Now, with an update on the impact of the pandemic on the automotive market and what the future holds for the sector, is Mike Hawes, CEO of the Society of Motor Manufacturers and Traders, talking to Ford Ennals. Then we will hear from Rosie Smith of World DAB and Lawrence Harrison of Radio Player.
Hello, I'm joined now by Mike Hawes, who's the chief executive of the SMMT. He's the organisation that represents the automotive industry in the UK. Mike, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
It's very, very good. Very good to see you. We're going to talk a bit about, obviously, the automotive industry in 2020, probably a year you want to forget. But also I'll be asking you about what you're expecting, you know, in the next couple of years and where all of this is going. No doubt you understand that for the radio industry, the car is a very important place. And the fact that several million of them are sold every year with bringing radios and in most cases digital radios has been great news for the radio industry. So this has obviously been an incredibly challenging year for all of us and for all businesses, and I would say probably particularly for the automotive industry. How would you summarise the impact of the pandemic for your industry?
Pretty brutal. We were probably more badly affected than many sectors, but not as badly as others. Obviously, hospitality is one that obviously springs to mind when you think of the most affected. But even across manufacturing, you know, some parts of manufacturing, think food and drink, pharmaceuticals, most obviously, working all hours, godsend. We had to shut down in terms of manufacturing. So we had a couple of months where we were producing, production was down like 95%. It was just a handful of cars we were making. Then you look at the retail side, equally shut. You know, there was no ability to buy a car and no appetite to buy a car either. Or anything else. It's begun to pick up, but, you know, overall, I think we'll probably see production down and sales down probably something around 30% this year. Ironically, the only bright spot you'll see, you know, towards at the back end of this year is sales of, you know, vans have obviously, you know, accelerated because that's how we're getting our food and increasingly our goods from the high street.
Indeed. And you mentioned the retail side and what we know as the dealer showrooms and car dealers, and am I right in saying they closed in both lockdowns?
Yeah, they were. We were obviously closed when we went to lockdown in March, reopened June. We were able to reopen ahead of most of the rest of non-essential retail. But again, in England, they reopened. They were shut for the lockdown, only just reopened. It obviously varies from Wales to Northern Ireland to Scotland and so forth. And some of the lessons that we learned in the first lockdown were applied to this one. So much more click and collect type operations, which have taken place. And because you knew it was for a finite time, when it went in March, we didn't know how long this was going to last. And to a certain extent, I think the general public said, okay, we'll get through this 4 weeks, then we'll see where we are.
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't know what's going to happen in the future, but it's COVID secure environment. It's not like going into a high street shop. There's a lot of space. There's an outdoor as well as an indoor. So, you know, of a retail environment, it's a safer place, more obviously than many others.
Now, I think I'm right in saying, I think last year in 2019, you sold about 2.3 million cars in the year. I mean, off your peak of about 2.6 a few years ago. So you said you thought sales for this year would be about 30% down?
About 1.6 million, something around there. The last lockdown hasn't helped. We'll see how much that gives a boost to December. Ironically, I mean, December is not normally a very strong month for new car sales. Brits don't tend to give one another cars as Christmas presents. The Americans do. America, December is one of the busiest months. I think we're a bit more constrained in our spending.
Yeah. And then I think your organization has looked forward, hasn't they, over to 2021 and 22. What do you expect the demand and sales to be going forward?
Difficult to forecast. Production, we can obviously 80% of what we produce is exported, so we're at the whim of what the level of demand is, not just in the UK but major international markets, obviously the rest of Europe first and foremost. Vaccine gives a lot of people encouragement. You know, obviously it's going to do, hopefully it'll do what we needed to do, and that save lives. But also just its availability, and the more you can get society back to normal, hopefully that'll give more consumers and businesses more confidence, because, you know, obviously the dramatic fall in GDP in the UK and elsewhere. Yes, we will be growing next year, but we won't be back to where we were. So, you know, purchasing a car is normally a discretionary purchase. So, you know, if you are feeling like belt needs to be tightened, you'll delay it and you'll put it off. And that's not what we need as an industry. Given the particular challenges we've got about meeting environmental goals as well, delaying purchasing doesn't help that either. So I think for next year, I think, you know, as you get towards the second half of the year, I think we'll have more confidence about where economies are and where society is as a result. And that will probably flow through to our industry.
I'm going to shift gear now, Mike, and focus really in on radio, because this is a video being watched by the many people in the radio industry. And do you think your industry and your members still recognize the importance of radio and how many passengers and obviously drivers listen to the radio in their cars?
Absolutely. I think, you know, you alluded to it earlier. The changing nature of infotainment within a car is significant, and that is moving on apace. The level of technology we've got about, we're not going to get to self-driving cars in a single bound, but incremental improvements to road safety potentially gives people more time in the vehicle without actually having to be solely focused on the driving task. That opens up some opportunities. Invariably, when people are in the car, they want that form of entertainment or information around them. Often that's radio. Competition is undoubtedly getting greater in terms of other forms of providing that information, providing the content. And that's where the challenges to the radio to make sure that they still can be relevant. And certainly, you know, what you do get with radio is that up to the minute broadcast to all approach, which, I mean, it can be a very shared experience.
So your members still, I think, recognize the importance of radio and obviously fitting radios in all cars.
Yeah, we have. And, you know, as you know, the level of fitment for digital radio in particular is something like 94-95% now. And, you know, that's been increasing over the past 10 years or so. And invariably, when people are purchasing a vehicle, why are they attracted? What do they particularly like about a particular vehicle? And invariably, the environment that they're in often features highly, and having that increasing connectivity in a vehicle, but also, you know, the internal environment, and that's certainly part of it.
Well, and at this point, I probably should recognise that in the last 10 years, as you say, digital fitment in cars has gone from 4% to 94%, which is a phenomenal achievement. And I wanted to actually thank you, the SMMT, and all your members for making that happen, because it has made a huge difference. And hopefully it's made a difference for people who are in their car journeys as well.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, what people appreciate is the clarity that you get from digital radio. It's, you know, the lack of reception, the level, the choice obviously is much, much greater than it would be otherwise. And as long as people can, you know, I mean, this is, we're also today, access it. And, you know, one of the challenges always in terms of facing the UK is about being able to access digital broadcast, being able to access 2, 3G, 4G or whatever, for other reasons, for, you know, in terms of driving. You know, we want the UK to be at the forefront of the technological shift. I mean, we're an advanced country. We should be leading it. We need sometimes the infrastructure, certainly when we are thinking of what's going to happen to the evolution of the vehicle and more, you know, connectivity, the provision of information, making sure we've got 4G and 5G can help you leap towards some of the safer technologies more quickly. So, you know, we're focused on that as well as obviously in terms of, you know, broadcast reception.
Well, I wanted to just close again by restating, you know, the radio industry's thanks to you and your colleagues and your members. I mean, there are now many hundreds of digital stations on air, and, you know, increasingly amount of time is spent listening to those stations in car, and it couldn't have happened without that transition you referred to, the journey from 4% to 94%. So our thanks to you, Mike, and thank you so much for spending time.
Good to see you again. Thanks very much indeed.
It's nice to see you, Mike. Take care. Bye-bye. Having talked to Mike Horse and the SMMT about radio in cars in the UK, I wanted to look more broadly at the picture across Europe, but also look to the future. And, you know, I'm now joined by two experts on that field. And I'm absolutely delighted to welcome Rosie Smith, who's the project manager of automotive for World DAB. Welcome,
Hello.
Rosie.
Hello.
Good to see you. And I'm also joined by my old friend and colleague, Lawrence Harrison, who's the Director of Automotive Partnerships at Radio Player. Lawrence, welcome.
Hi there. Thanks for having me.
Rosie, turning to you, I think just recently there's been an EU directive, I think in 2020, that asked to mandate digital radio receivers in new cars across Europe. We've seen that adopted in the UK. But can you tell us about what's happening in Europe, and is it going to make a big difference to the fitment of digital radio in cars?
Yeah, so similarly to the UK, I think this has given clarity to the market in Europe and to the vehicle manufacturers. They've had a clear date to work towards, and that date is coming up very quickly, the 21st of December 2020.
Yeah.
All new cars in Europe will have digital radio as standard, and across all markets, regardless of where they are in DAB development, they all have to now have new cars for digital radio. So this is going to be a huge sea change, and we're very pleased about this because it does give everybody security, knowing that they will have services on air in the car now and in the future. We're not seeing any country that is dragging its heels, and we're also seeing that all the vehicle manufacturers are ready. So that's great news for Europe and for the UK as well. If we ever get to travel again, you will be able to drive from one place to the another and still have digital services.
Now, Lawrence, when we talked to Mike Hawes, as well as the digital radio fitment in cars, he talked about the increasing connectivity in cars, which I guess is a major theme now. And I wondered how you feel now, particularly in your new role, about radio's place in the car and whether we're going to get squeezed by the likes of Google and Amazon and Apple. Or how will radio keep its prominence and keep relevant in the car?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And that's the sort of thing that occupies a lot of my time and our time in Radio Player. I mean, the first thing to say is that, you know, of course, Mike's right. The vast majority of cars now are coming with built-in connectivity. And I think it's really important to point out that we don't see any evidence that that will come at the expense of broadcast radio. So we still see, partly because of the regulations that Rosie just talked about, but also because, you know, there's huge listening on broadcast DAB digital radio in the car, and it's free to air. And if you're streaming, you know, audio or radio over the internet, there's a cost to that. And in these difficult times, that's important. So yes, connectivity is coming, but that, not at the expense of broadcast radio. To your broader question about, I guess, radio strength in the dashboard, we absolutely, even though broadcast will remain, we cannot be complacent. And you're absolutely right. The growth of connectivity in the car does mean an increase in competition, as well as new technologies like Android Automotive, because what that's going to mean, that's Google's new operating system. And what that will mean is that the dashboard effectively becomes an app store. No longer will you have to connect your phone to get access to an app store. You'll be able to download apps direct from your dashboard. And that plus connectivity means more competition. So radio, we need to be on our toes to keep radio strong in the car. And I think there are two main things that the industry needs to do. The first one is to collaborate, because those competitors in the car tend to be large tech companies with very deep pockets, and they're investing huge amounts of money in the experience of their services in the car. So radio can't really compete on a national basis. We have to come together, at least across Europe, if not globally, and work together to keep radio strong. And the second thing is to really invest in the user experience. And we believe, and I think the vast majority of the industry believes, that that's around hybrid radio. So that's DAB and FM working together with the internet. So you get the best of robust broadcast free-to-air backbone working with the internet connection for a return path, and also data that can provide a really rich app-like experience. So we're really focusing on hybrid radio being the standard experience in all cars of the future. And that has to be supported by great metadata. And that's something that I've been working with Rosie on over the last few months.
Brilliant. And I'm glad you mentioned metadata, because that is something I wanted you to explain to us a little bit more about what that is, because there'll be some non-broadcasters on this call. So Rosie, can you talk to us a little bit about what metadata is, and can you tell us what the World DAB Automotive Group is doing to support that?
Yeah, well, following on from what Lawrence has just said, we want to make the experience for drivers in the car of radio, both audio and visuals, the best it can possibly be. So World DAB's been working on a campaign to explain exactly, as you say, what is metadata and how do broadcasters use the metadata that they have, even if they don't know they have it, and transfer that into a really rich experience in the car. And we've created a short animation to explain it, and we've got information sheets and FAQs and all sorts of technical information as well. But on a very basic level, we want to make sure that broadcasters at the very least have their logo on the screen in the car, in the right size, in the right resolution, and their brand is there every time someone turns the radio on. At a more advanced level, we want broadcasters to present their stations in a way that is richer. So artist name, title of the song, things like that, what's coming next. So having that experience in the car of radio that is both audio and visual, but also making sure it's safe for the driver. So we don't want to take away what is a very safe experience for radio at this time by putting too many things on the screen. So World DAB and the automotive group of World DAB are working on some guidelines for slideshow to make sure that slides are clear and show your brand, but without taking the driver away from his main function, driving the car.
Brilliant. Well, look, I mean, my thanks to both of you for taking the time to join us. I mean, my conclusion certainly is that, you know, the radio industry is very focused on the car and the experience in car, and obviously looking to the future. I mean, it looks like it's going to be challenging, but at least I think you have a very good grasp of the issues, and you're making the right investments and innovations. So thank you for joining us, and wish you well. And is it too early to say Happy Christmas?
No,
I think
early.
You can get away with that. And thanks for having me, and I hope the event goes well.
Thank you so much.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
Now let's find out about the international growth of digital radio. Here's Patrick Hannon, president of World DAB, in conversation with Yvette Dorr, with an update on key developments worldwide.
I'm delighted to be joined now by Patrick Hannon, who is the president of World DAB, and that's the organisation facilitating the global rollout of DAB. Hello, Patrick.
Good afternoon.
Patrick, you're going to be updating us on developments in DAB around the world and on the key initiatives that are helping to deliver the platform's international growth. So I think you've got a few slides to share with us, and then we'll have a chat.
So I think I've got five slides, and as you say, it's a quick international update. So here we go. The first thing to say, 2020, in spite of all our troubles, has actually been a good year for DAB. When we look at Europe in particular, there's really strong progress, major markets continuing to expand. Germany most recently launched a second national multiplex in October of this year. France will have 10 cities on air by the end of this the end of 2020 and is launching two national multiplexes in next summer. And then the third major market is Italy, who introduced regulation at the beginning of this year, which requires all receivers, both automotive and consumer, to have DAB+. And I'll talk a bit about that later on. So those are the major markets, but then we've also got the most advanced markets, and the first countries are now switching off FM. We have Norway, which I guess we all know about, switched off FM in 2017. Interesting to note that they achieved record radio listening in July 2020. And now we have Switzerland, who are planning to switch off between 2022 and 2023. So that's the direction of travel. Then we've got the EU. EU is supporting digital radio, especially in cars. And they introduced the European Electronic Communications Code 2 years ago now, nearly 2 years ago. And this requires all new car radios anywhere in the EU, they must be able to receive digital terrestrial radio. So that's when, when they're sold in new cars. That law takes effect 21st of December 2020, though in individual countries, there are some delays due to COVID. Having said that, Germany, Italy, and the UK all have laws in place already. And those three countries alone account for 50% of all European car sales. And then finally, we have consumer receivers. So slightly different picture here. The EU decided that this should be a national decision. So any regulation needs to be done on a national basis. The first country to do so, as I mentioned at the start, is Italy. They require consumer receivers, all consumer receivers, to have DAB+. That law took effect in January of this year. And what you can see from this chart is what's happened to their sales figures. So in 2020, their sales have almost tripled year on year. In comparison, you can see that the other countries are, in the case of the UK, slightly down or growing, in moderate numbers. So the Italy has really made a significant impact. Other countries now are deciding if they're going to follow a similar path. And Yvette, that's it. That was a brief summary. I will now hand back to you.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much. There's clearly lots of activity and some interesting takeouts for us in the UK. So let's just talk about those for a little bit. Now, starting with the global rollout of DAB and DAB Plus and how that's developing, the UK has always been the market leader and a pioneer in DAB. But now it's clearly fair to say that many other countries have joined us in adopting DAB and even more are coming on board.
No, absolutely. I think, as you say, UK, Norway, Switzerland, and Australia, they really sort of the pioneers. But that, what we've now clearly got is DAB and DAB, really DAB Plus, established as a European standard. Started with Germany in 2011, and then after that, it's just been dominoes falling as other countries have joined the party. And in the end, that's what was recognised by the European Union.
So you just told us that Norway switched off analog in 2017 and Switzerland is planning to switch off in 2022-23, but this isn't the approach we're taking in the UK. So what are the key factors driving those markets to opt for a switchover policy?
Well, the key thing for any market is really two factors, the economics for the broadcasters and listener behavior. And really, it's a balance between those two things. What we know, obviously broadcasting on both FM and DAB, you know, is not the most efficient way of doing things. You've got a dual cost. So that's an issue on the economic side. However, broadcasters are understandably cautious about switching off before the listeners are ready. And that's a balance that people have to figure out for themselves, really. I think one thing that's interesting, looking at Switzerland, they've been tracking a number of metrics. Many of those metrics are the same metrics as we use in the UK. But one, I think, is worth highlighting, and that's the number of people who rely solely on FM for their FM devices for their listening. And what they found is that, these are figures from earlier this year, 15% of listeners, only 15% of listeners now are only using FM receivers. And that number has sort of fallen steadily over a number of years. And so they have that metric. When we look at just for comparison, in the UK, the equivalent figure at the end of 2019 would have been about 24%. So, somewhat higher than the 15%, but it is coming down, because if you go back to the end of 2018, it was 29%. So we can see the direction of travel there. And in the end, as I say, each individual country needs to make their own decisions. It is a judgment. There isn't one right answer. But it's clear that, as I say, first Norway and now Switzerland, think that this is a feasible and cost-effective option for them.
So the UK car market is already well advanced, and through our ongoing collaboration with automotive manufacturers, the percentage of new cars with DAB fitted as standard has increased from 4% to 94% over the last 10 years. And this, the new requirement that you've just talked about, will see this increase to virtually 100% of new cars in the UK. But how quickly will that transformation that took 10 years here now be in Europe?
Well, really interesting. I mean, the UK has absolutely led the way here, and credit to DR UK and the car makers themselves. What we've seen is that having made it possible in the UK, car makers in Europe 2 years ago, about one third of new cars came with DAB as standard. That was in 2018. The figure already is up to 50%. So moving, the UK, it took 10 years to make that transition. The rest of Europe is moving more quickly. It's already moving more quickly. But with the regulation, that means that really by the end of next year, you are looking at 100% or close to 100% will have DAB as standard. I think if I sum it up, the regulation is actually accelerating a trend that was already in place. And that's a key takeaway. Have regulation that helps you build on the momentum that's already in the market.
And I think people are often surprised when they hear the percentage of radio sold that are still analog only. So what's the significance of the consumer receiver regulation in Europe?
Well, no, very, very interesting. You say surprised. In my case, shocked when I see those figures. It's true. Something like two thirds of radio sold in Europe, in countries that have got DAB, two thirds of them are still analog only. In the UK, the figure is about 50%, 50-50. But what I showed was the one country that has introduced legislation for all consumer receivers to have DAB Plus is Italy, and it's completely transformed the market. They've more or less tripled their sales year on year. That was from a relatively low base, but the point is that legislation is working with a trend that is already in place, but is accelerating it. And as I say, it's up to individual countries now to decide whether they want to follow the same path. We know that conversations are taking place, certainly in Germany, certainly in Benelux regions. It's also a live issue here in the UK. And certainly as World DAB, we see absolute merit in, first of all, this legislation being introduced, but also for it to be introduced in a number of different countries at the same time, because that will make it easier for the manufacturers.
Thank you. Patrick, I think that's all we've got time for today, but it's been absolutely great talking to you. And thank you so much for giving us such an interesting tour of international progress.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Now let's go back to Ford and Avet for an update on the Government and Industry Radio and Audio Review, with contributions from Minister John Whittingdale and Ian O'Neill from the government's DCMS.
We couldn't finish our review of 2020 without talking about the support of government for the radio sector and the radio and audio review that is well advanced. The review was triggered by the achievement of 50% digital listening, and it's well underway. And we're going to hear more from that from Yvette, who is supporting DCMS and acting as project manager for the review. So we'll hear more from Yvette in a second. But before we do, it's probably worth hearing again from the Minister, John Whittingdale, who, when he was asked by Amal Rajan on the media show, this is what he had to say about the future of radio and indeed the role of FM.
What's your instinct on when FM can be turned off?
Well, we've announced the radio review, which is looking at the long-term future for radio, and that isn't just when do we switch off FM. I mean, I can remember the debate around switching off FM about sort of 15 years ago. I mean, obviously, it wasn't even really possible until we'd had greater take-up and we'd solved the issue around cars. Those things are slowly taking place. You know, new cars now all have DAB radios. People, DAB listening is, a proportion is still increasing. We're not there yet.
What's your instinct though? Where's your head on it? What are you thinking?
I mean, I think it's probably, I'm very reluctant to put a date on it because people immediately sort of pencil it in their diaries. But I think it's probably a good 10 years off. I mean, one of the things which we've just done, which you might touch on, is that, as you all have seen, we've extended analog licenses. One of the reasons being that, you know, we think we'll extend it 10 years, which is possibly about the time we might think about switching off analog transmission. But, you know, the radio review is out there actually to examine and listen to views on precisely these questions.
So, to hear a little bit more about where the review is and when it's going to report, here's Yvette.
Thank you, Ford. So the review, as we've heard, is a combined government and industry-led project which brings together government, broadcasters, Ofcom and the supply chain to collaborate on a programme of work to ensure a healthy and vibrant digital future for UK radio and audio. The growth of connected devices and new online audio platforms means that the audio market is rapidly changing, and the review is examining these future trends and considering how radio should adapt to the challenges and opportunities that these developments bring. So the review was set fully underway in February 2020, and despite the challenges posed by COVID, this process has been progressing this year. The intention remains to report findings at the end of March 2021, but the onset of the pandemic did understandably set some things back, so we may need to allow for that. But let's hear more from Ian O'Neill, who is head of radio at the DCMS.
This is a joint government and industry-led project, which is chaired by DCMS, which brings together the radio industry and stakeholders, and its aim is to ensure and set plans for a vibrant and healthy long-term future for UK radio. It was set up in the aftermath of the UK reaching 50% of digital listening, but it isn't focused around the decision on a digital radio switchover. It's more about assessing radio's future in the wider audio market and making sure that UK radio and content continues to thrive in the future. And this is really important because of the growing competition from new and evolving forms of audio and platforms.
So what kind of areas will the review be focusing on?
Well, the review will look at essentially three areas. Firstly, it will look at listeners, where they will be in the future, how their patterns of consumption are changing, given the increased demand from streaming services and online services. It's looking then at devices, what sort of devices they'll be looking on and what sort of content will they be consuming. And we've done some work already to model those future scenarios and take into account some of those changes. The second area is on devices themselves and on technology, and the technology in cars and vehicles. For example, smart speakers are now establishing themselves. They've made progress in both the United States and in Australia, and they're taking root and growing as audio devices in the UK. And we need to understand what this means for the future of radio. The final area for the review is to look at the future position of radio platforms. In the UK, we have a number of radio platforms, and we need to work with the radio industry on where it should invest in terms of the speed and timing of the retirement of medium wave, and then, you know, possibly FM in the future, and whether and how long to continue to invest in FM, and where and when to be building out further DAB, if that's where the radio industry needs and wants to go to. So there's quite a lot within the review, and we're working, as I said, with a number of radio organisations as part of this. We're also working with Ofcom, who, although not formally part of the review, will be providing a report to us on the state of coverage and broadcast networks, which will be the basis for future consideration on distribution. But the review, as well as looking at voice-activated speaker devices for the first time in detail, the review will also be looking at issues like environmental costs. So in looking at the future needs of the network, it's one of the things that we will have to sort of plan what is the most effective long-term situation to maintain robust and healthy broadcast networks, whilst, you know, contributing towards the UK's push to zero net carbon.
Yeah, I mean, I've been working quite closely with you on the review, and I know there's a lot to do. So how are things progressing?
Well, it is a challenge. I think, you know, the review and details were launched in February, and then immediately we had the impact of COVID-19, and that affected our time, and obviously for the radio industry, having to deal with such a significant impact on revenues. But there's some very good work going on, and, you know, we are making progress towards a timescale of completion in spring next year. The way the review will run is that, and this is why it's a government and industry review, is that there will be recommendations for that will be agreed across the industry, that the industry can take forward in terms of improving how radio and radio's offer, whether that's investment in content or getting behind digital radio in one of many ways. But there will also be recommendations for government and for the regulator in terms of this. So the report will lead to a further consideration by DCMS, and those are things that will be considered through the rest of next year.
Thank you, Ian, and thanks, Yvette. It's very good to hear a little bit more about the progress being made on the review, and we very much look forward to hearing the findings early in 2021. So that's Drive to Digital 2020, a virtual event like so many other this year. And obviously we look forward to next year. We look forward to a different kind of year. Hopefully we'll be the other side of this pandemic, and hopefully we'll get to see each other and collaborate together in person. But we thank you so much for listening. We thank you so much for what you're doing for the radio industry. And as I said, we're looking forward with hope and optimism. And we're also looking forward to Christmas. And it would be wrong not to mark Christmas, because it's a very important period. And I'm going to hand over to Yvette, who's going to talk a little bit more about the Christmas campaign.
Thank you, Ford. Yes, so our annual digital radio Christmas campaign is on air now across commercial stations. And this year, the campaign alludes to the familiar sounds of Christmas, which even this year haven't changed, and encourages listeners to add some sparkle to their soundtrack with the gift of a DAB digital radio or a smart speaker. So let's have a listen.
The sounds of Christmas haven't changed. Sleigh bells, Santa Claus, 70s classics.
It's Christmas!
Sung by Dad. And you can add some serious sparkle to someone's soundtrack now and for the rest of the year by giving the gift of digital radio. They'll unwrap music, entertainment, comedy, sport, news, and even podcasts with more great stations and exclusive content that's not just for Christmas. It's as easy as gifting them a DAB digital radio or smart speaker, available in-store and online from John Lewis, Currys and Argos. Love radio. Give digital.
Okay, so that really is it. My thanks to everybody. Obviously, thanks to you for taking the time to listen to some or all of this. My thanks, of course, to Yvette. My thanks to Lucy Forster, to the wonderful Paul Collins Redden, who did a great job editing the video together. My thanks to Radio Academy, Radio Festival, World DAB, who were very generous in letting us use some of their footage. And of course, my thanks to all our brilliant contributors.
Thank you, Ford. So thank you so much for watching, everyone. Have a happy and healthy Christmas. And my Christmas wish is that we'll see each other in person in 2021. Thank you.
Happy Christmas, everybody.
Thank you for watching, everyone, and have a wonderful Christmas.